Hey friends, troubleshooting distributed systems can be time-consuming and difficult, especially when you don't know where to start. Health modeling and observability are essential concepts that focus on robust and contextualized instrumentation and monitoring. Sebastian Botter is here to show me how health modeling differs from just simple monitoring, especially for mission-critical applications today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. Sebastian's here to teach me all about health modeling in mission critical workloads. You know, Sebastian, I've got a blog and I've got a dashboard in App Insights. I think I'm pretty much done, right? I have a healthy site.
I'm sure you do. And I'm sure you know when your site is healthy, right? So, I mean, who doesn't have a dashboard? Everyone has a dashboard, right? We do monitoring and like we collect metrics and, right? We all do this. I guess Your blog does that as well.
Exactly.
Let me show you something. Okay, this is our dashboard. Like, what do you see? You see tons of metrics.
Yeah, I mean, I see a lot of cool graphs. Some of them are going up. I don't know if up is good or bad right now, but it looks cool.
Exactly, right? It looks cool, but that doesn't help you anything. Like, what's this here? Like, backend request count. It goes up. I can tell you this is great because, well, the day is just starting here. Like, you know, like we expect traffic to go up, right? But you have no idea when what this means. And likewise, if I'm looking at your dashboard, I would have likewise no idea, right? And this is not how we can like run really mission-critical applications. We need to be able to tell what's going on in my application. I mean, to tell about, is my application healthy? That's what we want to know, right?
Yeah, that's a really good point because actually, if you looked at my dashboard, when my graphs go up, it's bad, you know, because it might be a queue length that's too long or it might be a request time that's taking too long. So I'm just sitting here looking at your dashboard. I'm realizing that this one looks like something's bad, but yours says it's healthy and mine looks different. So neither of us has one that a new person can look at a glance and get
exactly
health.
Exactly. And so, yeah, that's where health modeling comes into play. And health modeling obviously builds on top of monitoring, right? We still need all those metrics. We need to collect the logs. We need to like sift through the logs. We need all that. But what we also want, we want to contextualize that information. We want to like put in our business flow there, or like user flows, system flows, and business requirements. That's what we want to determine when our system is healthy and whatnot.
Okay, that makes sense. Okay. So this feels very intentional. Like you're being deliberate. You're sitting down and you're thinking about what does health mean to me, my team, my app, my applets, and all the different pieces of my application. Because these are distributed systems and failures are going to happen, but I need to decide if a failure indicates deeply unhealthy or just a hiccup in the process.
That's a super valid point you just mentioned there. Like failures will happen, right? And that's especially true when you're running distributed systems, like in the cloud. Like we can't just rely on the hardware, like always be there. Like maybe you did like 30 years ago when you had your own big server in the basement. Today, we just need to anticipate failure. And ideally we build our applications in a way that they can handle failure automatically. And again, this is where health modeling comes into play for two things. A, to give our operators an easy view, but also then later to like do automation on there, like to automatically self-heal our applications.
That's a good point, because one of them might mean someone gets paged, like we wake you up in the middle of the night, and another one might be, well, we'll let them know in the morning, but we'll heal between now and then.
Exactly. So to give you a bit more context of what we just saw, or just looked at, right? The application behind the dashboard we see is basically this here. So as we saw, it's like a distributed application. It's running on Azure, obviously. It has lots of components. It has like, I don't know, it has a front door, and the Cosmos DB, two regions right now, like in two different Azure regions, AKS and all that stuff, right? So there are a lot of components here. Just want to show you this to actually show you, give you a bit of context.
Yeah, it's non-trivial. There's a lot going on there.
Exactly. Any of those components can fail, right? And eventually, as you just said, any of them will fail. So with that, let's actually look at our health monitoring dashboard.
So it sounds like health monitoring really is contextualizing those things, because if one thing fails, like if a CDN fails and a couple of pictures don't load, that's not awesome, but it's not catastrophic. But
exactly.
If it happens to be the CDN that loads my JavaScript, then that might be catastrophic.
Exactly. You made a great point. So let's actually start looking at this one here.
Okay.
So this is what we now call our hierarchical health model. So we can see a number of things here. And like one thing you just mentioned, like parts of your application not working. And this is exactly the what we call the first layer here. Actually try to cycle through here. So this is the layer of what we call user flows. So we have one that we call like show static content user flow, right? Exactly your example you just made, like where you need a CDN, for example, and where it's being served from, it's served from a blob storage. And what you can say now, like you have no idea about my application, but you can immediately say, okay, there's something not quite right here, right? It's not red, which is good, but it's yellow. But because this storage account apparently has some problem, but our other user flows, like we have another one here, list catalog items user flow, or like add comment user flow, those are totally independent of that storage account, and they are all good. Right, so you have two informations now, which you didn't have before when you just looked at the dashboard. A, you know something's not quite right, and you know where to start looking, maybe at the storage account down here.
Interesting. And this diagram that you're showing, this isn't just some static bunch of SVGs that you put into a markdown file. This is live. This is an alternative dashboard that's truly giving me not just the health of my site, but also a little bit of sense of the architecture.
Exactly. And we're going to dive a bit more deeper into what's actually behind this. But before we do, just let's take another look at the dashboard here. Mm-hmm. So as we said, first of all, we have two regions deployed, and this we can actually see it here. We have one in UK and one in Sweden running. The Sweden one is totally working fine, which is great. And again, this is also where our like self-healing comes into play, which we talked earlier. So we have front door. So right now, front door will actually direct more traffic to UK than to Sweden, because we realize, okay, something's wrong here. We can also, if we look down here, we can see over the last day what it is. Apparently, something wasn't quite as right in Sweden, right? We can see, okay, lots of like red states. And if we would have like looked at the dashboard at one of those times, then actually one of the bubbles up there would have been red.
Interesting. You missed an opportunity for a something is rotten in Denmark joke, but I'll let that go. So I love that health status over time. So you're actually seeing that it's getting increasingly unhealthy as we move from left to right. So we're learning that that site is starting to rot. Something's definitely wrong.
Exactly. And if we look down here, we can actually see what is causing that thing to go to turn red right now. So again, it's our public blob storage. We've seen this before, right? And we see, okay, the average latency is pretty high already with the value there of 170 milliseconds. And especially the failure count is going up. Like ideally you want a failure count of probably zero, right? That's what healthy is. And it's pretty high right now. So again, this is now where you know where to focus on, where to start your troubleshooting.
Interesting. Okay. So you're going to teach me how to make one of these. So I'm still excited about like how you made this, but I'm with you so far. This is definitely more advanced than just simple dashboards.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and because it's more advanced, it also means, to tell the truth, this is nothing you build in 10 minutes, because you need the knowledge of the application and you still need to know, okay, what do I want to look at, right? Because, and you need to know what's healthy for your application and what's unhealthy and what's degraded states in there and which metrics are important for you. So just to show you one example, let's actually look at one of the queries that's behind one of those bubbles there. But again, that's a one-time effort to build that thing. And afterwards, of course, you can refine it, but just people can use it. Even I could look at your application dashboard and I could start operating your application. So as an example here, that's the query for that storage account that we just looked at. And so all the data is being written to Azure Log Analytics under the hood, and we're using Kusto queries. So that's the KQL language. And for example, what you can see here, we're looking at the end-to-end success latency, because we've determined for our application that's a metric that's important for us. And we look at the storage errors as well, right? As you just seen there, some storage errors is what caused our application to go unhealthy.
Mm-hmm. So these Kusto queries are running in the context of what within Azure? Like, what is the thing that runs these? Are these just part of diagnostics or what?
Yeah, so the diagnostic settings is what collects the data. So we've enabled diagnostic settings on all our services, and we're using application insights as well for our custom code that's running on top of that, logging into application insights. And again, it's all going to a unified data sync. And on top of this, we're running those Kusto queries from the Grafana dashboard that we've just seen. And based on those queries, and here we can see an example where we defined, okay, the thresholds. So this is what we defined for our application as degraded and as unhealthy. So we see average latency over 100 is degraded, right? We've just seen like it was 171, I think. And the failure count above 2 is already degraded, and above 5 we see as unhealthy. And again, those numbers you need to define for your application. I can't do this for you. But once you've done that, then I can operate your app as well.
But if I change those failure counts to, like, you know, 200 and 400 or 3 and 10, suddenly my whole site turns green. I need to decide if that is, in fact, reality. And that's where we talk about being intentional. What does failure mean to us? What does degraded mean to us?
Yeah. As another example, like, you might run a couple of VMs or like an AKS cluster, right? In your cluster, you might be running on 80% CPU utilization all the time on average. That's great for you because you just have a high density and all is good. For my application, that's a really bad thing because I want to leave that headroom for like spikes in traffic. But for me, 80% is very bad already.
Yeah, that's a good point. And that really just, again, depends on what's going on. You might have noisy neighbor issues if you're running at 80%. But for a small website like mine, I like to run it at 60 or 70% because it saves me money and I don't have spikes. Again, this is really personalized. So it sounds like the solution you've got here is a starter point, and everyone's going to need to be deliberate in how they decide to model the health of their application.
Exactly. And you were asking about, like, how do you get started here and how do you get this? So all of this is open source on our GitHub repo. So under the Mission Critical repo on GitHub, and you find the link in the show notes. You can find all this, what I've just showed you. You can deploy this from scratch, including the queries and the Grafana as well. And you can use those as starting points for your application components. Of course, you might have different components, you might have different thresholds, but you can use that to get started.
How often is that graph getting updated, that Grafana that you've got? Because you've made a custom Grafana visualization to make that kind of family tree of your application. And how would I make one of those myself?
Exactly. Yeah. So the dashboard, the tree, you don't have to make yourself because it's a custom visual that we've built. And again, open source. So you can just use that thing. Mm-hmm. And how often you want to update it just depends on what settings you put in Grafana. So you can run it as often as every five seconds if you want to. Might not be meaningful because you need to just figure out, okay, how often does data get ingested? Like, most diagnostic settings lock like every 30 seconds or every 60 seconds of data. So you won't get more newer data more often, but that again just depends on your data collection settings.
Interesting. And then what is the relationship between this visualization, which is reading from that Azure Diagnostics, and alerts that I might want to get based on this health monitoring? Because right now I might have alerts that are based on what's happening in App Insights or based on some Kusto query. Can I use those same queries to be alerted of one of these degraded states?
Of course, you can use the exact same queries here. We can look up one of the queries, inspect. You can see the data here and you can see the queries that we're using. You could use the exact same queries then to build your alerting as well. Like, you could just use the same queries, say, okay, whenever that thing is not one or like whatever, like, one means unhealthy or so, then send out an alert. You could use the same queries because they are all stored inside Log Analytics.
This is so cool. And now I have to figure out how to make this happen. And you say if I just go to Mission Critical Online on GitHub, I can get started right away.
Exactly, you can. And yes, so the easiest place to get started is probably if you go to the Mission Critical Workload landing page on the Azure Learn pages. You also find all the documentation around this, like what we call the design areas, and one of them is, unsurprisingly, health modeling. So you find it all here. So basically, the more theoretical backgrounds behind this and all our recommendations and considerations you should put into building one of those things. But also then from here, if you go to the baseline reference architecture, first of all, you find the detailed description of this architecture that I just showed you, the entire application and how you can get started. You can deploy all of this in about like 45 minutes if you have an Azure DevOps organization and an Azure subscription. And then from here on, you can directly jump to the GitHub page and you'll land right there, what I just showed you.
Very cool. And then my last question is, you know, some of us may be using complicated or sophisticated architectures like this one with Kubernetes, and others might be using simple app services or Azure dashboards. Can I still have a cool health monitoring experience with a simpler or less complicated, less sophisticated system? Like, I just have a blog, but I'd love to have something like this expressed and really start to be more intentional about my dashboards and my health monitoring.
Of course, like while we built this, first and foremost for mission critical applications, a lot of stuff in the guidance you find there is still applicable for all kinds of different applications, right? Even your blog probably has like more than one component. It might have a database, might have an app service, and maybe a CDN layer. You can still build the same thing there and still get value out of that.
Well, that's brilliant. Well, thank you so much for educating me about this today.
Glad to have been here.
This is just one in a series on mission critical workloads on Azure. Today, I've been learning about health modeling that mission critical workload today on Azure Friday. Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.